tonight is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter, John, and James and went up the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of these things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met them. Just then, a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly, a spirit seizes him. All at once, he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. This is the word of God for the people of God.
I don't know, after that intro to the lesson, I'm nervous about this sermon. I almost feel like George Lucas needs to be up here crafting something dramatic. I was just going to talk about the two economies that we all have to live with, that our faith tradition frames for us in relationship to what the Transfiguration is about. That was really, I don't know how to respond to that. So anyways, be that as it may. Throughout the ages, the ancestors, the spiritual ancestors that preceded us had, especially in the early church, those ancients, we talk a lot about the two economies that people of faith had to live through, struggle with, make sense of. The temporal economy, which we all live with every day. You know, the stuff we need to do to put food on our table, a roof over our head, and clothes on our back, and gasoline in our cars and all that stuff, you know. And this is very important. It always has been very important for the church. Jesus understood that the temporal economy was very, very important to people. You know, when asked about taxes, he says, "Well, you know, give Caesar what belongs to Caesar, give God what belongs to God." That's temporal economy stuff. When he wanted to talk to Zacchaeus, who was hiding out in the tree, he wanted to sit down and have lunch with him. Of course, Zacchaeus was this tax collector who had cheated a lot of people. And so you can imagine what the conversation was going to be about. You know, about fairness, justice, those kinds of things. Temporal economy stuff. We have Peter, John, and James going up the mountaintop with Jesus in the Transfiguration story. John and James, you may remember in other parts of the first three Gospels, John and James, approaches Jesus about when Jesus comes into his kingdom. Will Jesus assign them the right seat and the left seat? Okay. In Luke's Gospel, John and James does not do that on their own accord. Their mother sort of pushes them. Go tell Jesus. This is what you need. This is what you want. It's not scriptural, but a whole folklore throughout the centuries developed around that. That John and James' mother enjoyed a certain amount of wealth and was one of the benefactors to the ministry, helped provide the economic resources so Jesus could go out and do this. And Jesus is mindful of that. You know? He's mindful of that. You just don't do your religious thing in a vacuum. You do it in a culture, in a society, in a place, in a time that requires stuff out of us. And so the temporal economy is always very important to the faith. Understanding that if we don't do certain things, we don't need it. We don't have a roof over our head. We don't survive. And the faith is always taught that those things are important. But you know, and I know, that sometimes we can get so much caught up in the matters of the temporal economy that we begin to lose sight of some pretty important stuff. We all know it doesn't make any sense to work 80, 90 hours a day, a week. But there are people who do it. We all know that just taking care of the economics of living through everyday life isn't going to necessarily make a person feel whole or happy or joyful. And so the faith always taught that there's a second economy out there. And the second economy is what tradition has been called the eternal economy, that inbreaking into the temporal of God's eternity. And especially from those who come out of the Gospel of John perspective, because John's Gospel has this sort of woven through its characters, this idea that everyday life that we live, the basic nuts and bolts things we need to do to survive, is interrupted with God breaking in with eternity, so that eternity is brushing up against us, so that we'll get a different perspective than just the perspective the temporal economy gives us. And the church throughout its history has always said, if you want to have a healthy soul, a healthy spirit, you need to hold in tension the temporal economy of our lives and the eternal economy of our lives. And if you neglect one or the other, your soul gets dark. The capacity to become alienated from oneself and from one's loved ones and from God. The eternal economy is necessary because it is that spark, that enthusiasm, that which drives human beings to noble things, noble pursuits, peace and justice, love, mercy, the capacity to care for one another. And so since the earliest days of the Judeo-Christian tradition, going all the way back 1500 years before Jesus comes along, you get the Ten Commandments, and you get this whole concept of Sabbath. You get this whole concept that we have to carve out of our time places so that our lives can brush up against this eternal economy. And if we don't, I love Walter Brueggemann. He's an Old Testament scholar. I've heard him speak a couple times. He's really crusty. Like Old Testament scholars, you'd expect Old Testament scholars to be crusty. But he says, God created the world in 6 days. Then on the seventh day, he rested. Because he knew he wouldn't rest, he'd want to whack someone. And that's Sabbath is so important that there needs to be a time in which we step out of the temporal economy if we want to keep our wits about us, if we want to keep grounded, if we want to keep perspective. And sometimes for most of us it's just, let's carve out a few hours every week to do that. But once in a while, you need more than a few hours every week. And so we have here this incredible story, the Transfiguration, where Jesus invites Peter, John, and James to go with him. I don't know why he chose the three of them. He just chose the three of them. Maybe he chose the others as well for these kinds of events, but this is the one that gets recorded. They go up to the mountain to step out of the day-to-day routine of meeting the requirements of the temporal economy, so that they can encounter a holy mystery that will re-energize their imagination and their faith, and to bring clarity about what lies ahead. And so they're up on a mountain and a cloud appears, and all of a sudden there's an apparition of Moses and of Elijah, and they're talking with Jesus, and Jesus is like made over into this like very bright, brilliant image. And the three disciples don't quite know what to make of it. And they get scared. And then they hear this voice from God. Listen to this guy. Listen to Jesus. You need to do this. You need to do this. And Jesus will help you with what is coming. And we all know the story. What is coming is not going to be fun. It's going to be pretty brutal. And then it all ends. Now in Matthew and in Mark, when they tell the story, the disciples are so impressed and so excited and so thrilled with this theophany, this moment, this experience with the eternal, that they want to build three little altars or three little booths or three little houses. They just want to hang up there and just hang out there with Jesus forever. Why go back? And we've all had those experiences when we've gone away, when we stepped out of the temporal economies of our lives and gone away, maybe to a campsite, maybe to the mountains, maybe to the seashore, maybe out in a boat in a lake or whatever. The sun is sinking in the sky and the moon is coming up and the stars, and you just are so impressed with this incredible event that's taking place around you, and you feel so connected to God, creation, to yourself. And the last thing you want to do is go back. Can't we just stay here forever? Can't we? So what the disciples are doing is very, very, very normal. We all understand it. We've all experienced it at different times in our lives. I don't know how many times I've done that Thursday night at camp week, at church camp, with the campfire and the communion by the campfire, the guitars, and they're all going back home the next morning, and they're all crying because they sense this presence of God that they've never sensed before, and they want to hold on to it forever. You know, St. Luke doesn't tell it that way. Once the theophany is over, once the voice of God is heard, he sends the disciples back down the mountain, where immediately they hit the temporal economy. A man's child, a boy, is sick. Jesus, will you do something? Will you do your job? Peter, John, and James, will you help Jesus do your job? Will you bring healing? Will you bring hope? Will you bring life? And so either Mark and Matthew give us this wonderful theophany and the disciples wanting this sort of thing up there. In Luke, almost immediately, they're forced to deal with the reality. And of course, Jesus is able. And he's able in part because he knows the eternal economy. It is what gives him the strength. It's what gives him the power. It's what gives him the skill and the ability to confront the temporal economy. And his only hope and prayer is that these three disciples he drug up the mountaintop with him learn the same thing. And that's his hope and prayer for us. That as we leave the safe, comfortable spaces of this room and go out into the world and deal every day with the temporal economy, the ups and downs, the successes, the failures, the weight and the pressure, the stress, we will have figured out that we have to have those transfigurational moments. That we have to figure out how to give ourselves permission to brush up against the eternal economy. And if we don't do that, if we don't figure out how, if we don't give ourselves permission, because the eternal economy is there, it's not a matter of doing anything to get it here, it's a matter of giving ourselves permission to allow it to have a place in our heart and soul. know that's going to happen to you. Because it has happened to you. And I know it's going to happen to me because it's happened to me. You pour so much of yourself in to the temporal economy that one day you hit a brick wall. And it's just too much. And you burn out. The transfiguration of our Lord teaches us that God's eternal presence is radically available. We just have to carve out some space for it. And if we carve out some space for it, when we come off the mountain and face all that stuff ahead of us, we'll find a way. And we'll not only find a way, we'll find a way to do it with a measure of joy and peace. But if we don't give ourselves permission to take advantage of the holy mystery of God's eternal presence breaking in all the time in and around us, then we come off that mountain and we see the person there meeting our energy. We go, oh Lord, got another one. That's how we view the world. With hope, peace, enthusiasm, grace, or dread. It's a matter of balancing the two economies. Know that you are loved in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm sorry, George Lucas wasn't here tonight.